Words are going to meet you today. Brett Foster is going to introduce my message today by just sharing his personal thoughts with you about serving. Today we're going to talk about serving the Lord, and I want Brett to come and just share a few minutes before I do.
All right. Thank you. When Pastor Paul asked me to do this, I got to be honest, I hesitated. It's been a long time since I've spoken in front of people, and this church looks a lot bigger from up here. So I was like, man, what if I stumble on my words? What if I, you know, what if I forget what I'm saying? What if I trip on the steps coming up? But then I quickly realized that it's not about me. And that's kind of what today is about. You know, it doesn't matter. I know that somebody here needs to hear what I have to say, and that's why I'm up here. So it doesn't matter if I'm nervous. It doesn't matter at all, because I know that God has given me something really quickly. I've never really had a heart for serving. You know, I've served in church my whole life in little bits and pieces, but I never really fully understood and appreciated the value of serving and what it meant until about 7 years ago. I was in, my wife and I were in Florida, and I went through something in my life that just wrecked me. It completely changed my life. It flipped everything upside down, and I knew that I needed to make some significant changes in my life to be the man that God's called me to be a better husband, to be a better friend, and to be closer to Him. And one of the things that I knew that I needed to do right away was I needed to serve. And my wife, if you guys know my wife, you know that she has a heart for serving. And she always has, and she's always got her hand in something that's changing the world. And so I decided that I'm going to jump into it. I'm going to serve. I'm going to give it my all, because I needed it in my life at that time. I was a broken man. And what I found that is as soon as I started to do it, as soon as I started to serve and give of myself and give of my time, God started to take those broken pieces, and He started to put me back together and to start making me whole. And the reason was that during that time, I was so focused on myself and so worried about, like, you know, what I need to do to change, how I feel, how everything around me is going. And, you know, it's all me, me, me. And what I found is when I started to serve, I was serving something that was bigger than me, something that wasn't about me anymore. And I got out of the way. You know, Brett got out of the way. That created space for God to work inside me. And as soon as He did, like as soon as I started to do that, my life changed completely. I started to see the Word of God in a clearer way. I started to love more intensely. I started to just have a better, more fuller, wholer relationship with God. And I believe that God rewards us for serving. And not like a car or money or anything like that, but I believe that God rewards us with clarity. He rewards us with clarity and with wisdom and understanding and a small glimpse of what it's like to be like Christ. And I believe wholeheartedly that the greatest gift that we can receive is anything that inches us closer to God. And a lot of times, I believe also that what is in the way of us and a closer relationship with God is ourselves. And whether it's our fears, our pride, our guilt and shame, preconceived ideas, whatever it may be, I believe that if we wholeheartedly dive into serving, to loving, to giving, there's absolutely no telling what God will do in us and through us. Thank you.
Amen. Wow. Awesome, Brett. Thank you so much. You'll be hearing more from Brett and Crystal. They're going to have a baby this week. Isn't that cool? Yeah, we all like babies, don't we? Oh, yeah. Man, well, you helped me, Brett. I appreciate it. And I want to share with you what the Lord has put on my heart today, and it is just, I guess, a simple title, Serve the Lord. It's pretty simple. It's we make it more complicated, I guess, than it really is. And do you know the devil would probably be pretty satisfied concerning you if he could just keep you busy? He doesn't really need more people doing bad stuff. Everything you're doing might be good. You know, we don't really need to be studying whether it's a sin or not. We just need to stick to the, is it God's will? And is it taking away from what I'm really supposed to be doing? Amen? I hired a guy one time that didn't have much experience in construction. I do construction work. And this guy didn't have much experience in construction, but he was coming to church and he needed a job. So I hired him, Bob, and I was just being nice, you know. And he got on the job, and it was apparent that he just didn't know what he was doing. And we would tell him something, and Wes, he would not do what we told him. And I had a guy working for me full-time at the time. And after we told the guy that was, we were setting trusses with a crane, and we told him, don't try to hold or move the truss while it's in the air because it will throw you off of that ladder. And he didn't comprehend that. And he jumped up on the ladder and grabbed the truss and went to swing it, and about that time it kicked back and threw him off onto the ground. And the guy that worked for me came up to me the end of the day, and he said, when are you going to fire him? And then he said, you know, every day that you keep him on the job, you're keeping him from doing something he's good at. And I thought, well, now that you put it that way, I don't want to hold him back. So I told him, I said, man, you're good at something, and it ain't this. So go find what it is and do it with all your heart, you know. And he was able to move on. And thank God, you know. But he didn't get hurt, and he didn't hurt anybody else, and all worked out good. And so we cannot sum up the Bible, 66 books and 1,168 chapters, in a sermon. And if someone pretends to do that, you might want to run. If you hear a preacher say, you know, all you need to know is dot, 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 you might want to take a deeper look into things, because this relationship with God, this Word of God, is there for a reason. The whole Bible is there for a reason, even Numbers. Believe it or not, God didn't put that in there to slow you down or make you mad or wear you out or confuse you. There's stuff in there that'll help you to get more out of some of the other stuff in there. Isn't that right? And so it's all God's Word. It's all important. However, Jesus was asked to sum up the law, and he did do that in about a sentence or two, and that's kind of what we're going to talk about today. He said, the law can be summed up like this, or the best laws are like this. love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. And really, all the 66 books are to help us work on that. It's either about loving God better and more and healthier and longer and stronger, or it's about loving others and doing more for them. That's really what it is all about, in a sense. So we have come up with core values here at the River that are on our wall over there, and it's just love God, love people, live with conviction. Amen. And then the last one, which almost everybody likes. I have run across a person or two that didn't think we ought to put that in there, but it says, have fun. The early church had fun. When you get, Paul Burley, when you get a message that someone is dying or has died and you intercede, and then you get a message and said, they're okay, that's fun. Raising the dead is fun. Healing cancer is fun. And standing out in the front of the church lawn with a bunch of teenagers playing cornhole is fun. And singing in praise team practice when the sound engineer keeps turning on too much delay and reverb is fun, or at least funny. It wasn't that sound engineer. It was another guy. He's tall and skinny, and he wears a blue suit coat on Sunday. Giving them the echo of their life and making it interesting, okay? And then to carry this out, our vision statement says, we're here to help people, all of you, not me, not Mike and Cindy, but all of you, are here in this building today to help people know God, find freedom, discover purpose, and make a difference like Crystal. Crystal makes a difference. Everybody say, be like Crystal.
Be like Crystal.
I love that saying. Be like Mike. Be like Crystal. Make a difference, right? So let's break that down a little bit. Because the world needs practical Christianity. And that know God part, you can take that and just go and go and go and go and go. We come in here to worship because why? We want to know God. And you can't introduce somebody to somebody you don't know. If you have a total stranger over here, you go to introduce them to a total stranger over here, you got nothing. You got nothing. You know, you don't know where they work. You don't even know their first name. You got nothing. You know, John Doe, meet John Doe. I don't know. I got nothing. But if you know God, if you know God, you can be a witness. If you've seen him, you can be a witness. If you've seen the actions of what his power can do, you can sing of his goodness. And others will see and believe. We want to help people know God and find freedom. Freedom can be found. Free indeed. Go on Tuesday night and find out what more you can know about finding freedom and what you can do to help others find freedom in their life. Because a self-centered life is bondage. If you wake up every morning and you've got something that's bothering you, something that's addicting you, something that you're bound to, something you can't get away. You know, there's people addicted to sleep. There's people addicted to pornography. There's people addicted to drugs. There's people addicted to family stuff. There's people addicted to all kinds of crazy things. Small, little things that separate, keep you from finding your purpose, your destiny, discovering who you really are, because you're just so consumed with this one thing that you can't get free from. But you can through the power of God, and that's why we're here, to help you find freedom so you can then discover your purpose. And so a lot of people get stuck in that first part or that second part, and they can't make a difference because they don't know who they are. They haven't gotten past that. And that's why we're here. That's what we're going to do. And when you go out today in the foyer and you see all those tables and you sign your name and your email up there, just do it. Just get in there, sign your name, say, put me to work, call me, and I'm going to do something for Jesus and see what God will do with it. Psalm 100 says, make a joyful noise. Shout to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God, as he has made us, and not ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Serve the Lord with gladness. Parents, if there's anything you can teach your children that will help them, one of the things you need to be working on with them is to serve with gladness. Amen? You tell them, I'll say, go wash that window. The next thing you tell them is, and smile while you're doing it. Go mow that yard real quick and smile big enough that the neighbors wonder what you're up to while you're mowing that grass with gladness. Could you get me a drink of water, please? Let me see that smile. Sure, Dad. Yes, Mother. I'll be glad to do that. It'll change your home atmosphere, I promise you. And you got Bible, so they can't give you pushback. You know what I'm saying? They got nothing. They got nothing. The joy of the Lord is your strength. It's a lot easier when you're smiling. Whistle while you work. Sing while you work. Wes has worked with me a lot. We sing, man. We whistle, we sing. We sing loud. Stand up, Danny. Oh, my goodness. Y'all got to see. This is my favorite T-shirt. I've never seen a T-shirt this good. Yeah, do a 360 real quick. Real men sing real loud. Is that not awesome? I love Danny. He's the man. Love your neighbor as yourself. If y'all, I'm skipping my scriptures, Kim, sorry, but it's Mark 12 and 28 through 44, and I'm going to save a little time here and go to the part that says, love your neighbor as yourself. Well, when anybody thinks that they've got all of Christianity worked out and they've graduated and they're doing the Bible, you know, self-righteousness, all you got to do is read that scripture. Love your neighbor as yourself, and it'll humble you real quick. Because there's just some stuff that I don't like to share. There's some stuff that I like for me. Right? I mean, come on. Love your neighbor as yourself. If you get road rage, that pretty well tells you that you're not preferring the person that's needing to get in front of you or thinks they need to get in front of you. Paula knows I talk to drivers. So they can't hear you. But I can, and you're depressing me. Stop. But I'm not going to carry that grudge. I'm going to let it out. vent, and, you know, she'd be my counsel, and I can get it off my chest, you know. They don't know me, so I can't go sit down face to face with them and say, who do you think you are, and why are you in such a hurry? Where are you going? It's so important. Love your neighbor as yourself. Prefer them. Give them the right of way. Give them your best, your first. If you're giving God your first, then it paves the way for you to give others your first and your best. But if you're holding stuff back from God, you're going to automatically hold stuff back from your spouse, your children, and others in your life. Love your neighbor as yourself. Last week we talked about that Samaritan story where the man said, who is my neighbor? And Jesus gave the story about the man that fell among thieves, and he said the Samaritan went down and he helped him. And that's your neighbor. The guy you didn't think was worthy, the guy you didn't think was any good, that's your neighbor. The person that don't look like you, act like you, dress like you, live in your neighborhood, still your neighbor. Pretty much opens it up, doesn't it? Let's turn to Galatians 5. So when we say love your neighbor, a lot of Americans and Christians, when you say love them, like, oh, I love them. Because you think love is a feeling. You think love is an attitude or a state of mind. I mean, no, love is way more than that. Every mother in here that's ever had a baby knows that loving your baby is more than just saying, I love you, baby. You got to get up with them at 3 a.m. You got to change diapers that don't smell like what you had in mind. Amen. You got to deal with stuff and attitudes, and you got to potty train them. You know what I mean? Like, potty training is messy. There's no clear, smooth, easy way to do that. Because once you commit to it, you're in. And you're in the middle of town, and there's traffic all around, and mama, I got to go. We put the potty chair in the car and sat it in the seat next to the car seat. That's a free tip for all you new mommies. It works. We pulled over on the side of the road, and Simeon's out there just going at it because he's potty training, and he don't know what hold it means when he's 2, right? It's love, but love has hands, feet, eyes, ears. Love gets dirty. Love gets nasty. Love gets woke up in the middle of the night and answers the phone sleepy sometimes. If I ever lie, it's probably because, did I wake you, Pastor? I'll say no, because technically the phone ringing woke me. You didn't technically wake me up. So I'm not technically lying. Amen. Love goes out of his way. Love is not just a feeling or a thought or a state of mind or 4 words. And when you tell somebody, I love you, you need to have something behind it. You need to mean it. They need to know it in a real and practical way. It feels good to hear it. And then don't get me wrong, keep saying it. I tell my wife I love her a lot because I do. And I think of it and I want her to know it. But I prove it with calloused hands. I prove it by being where she needs me to be at the time she needs. I prove it by doing acts, by serving her in the best way I know how. Galatians 5. For you, brethren, have been called to liberty. Only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Somebody say amen. Amen. Serving causes growth in you and in the body of Christ. The more people serving, the more serving by love, the more the body's going to grow. The scripture tells us that very clearly, that it's every joint supplying, and there's an outflow of growth. Someone said, what you serve, you become. You want to be more like Jesus? Serve Jesus. What you serve, you idolize. You got to be careful how much time you invest in stuff, because if you're not careful, it'll become an idol, something that you bow to, something that can cause you to do things, make decisions that are not best for you, best for the kingdom, best for God. In America, in our culture, in Christianity as well, a lot of people serve money. Money, if money is the decision maker on where you live, where you work, how long you work, if it's only because of the dollars, you might have a problem there with some idolatry. You're better off to make $2 or $3 an hour less, or get a week less vacation and do what's God's will for your career, than you are to take that raise and then miss out on serving the Lord in your life. You're better off to live in a neighborhood that may not be exactly what you wanted or where you wanted, if it's God's will for you, than you would be to go and live in a neighborhood just because the house payment was $100 less, and then your children suffer, or your family suffer, or whatever. Don't let money decide where you live. Money shouldn't be the deciding factor on the things that matter in your life. It's not about the money. Amen? It's about knowing God's will. Lay not up for yourselves treasure on earth, where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. It doesn't mean don't plan for the future. It doesn't mean don't save. But let me tell you something. Invest whatever you want to invest in. Whatever you think is the most solid investment, go for it. But I'm going to tell you something. I lost 4 friends this week. None of them were old enough to say, oh, they lived a good life and they finished their course. 4 in 1 week. You know how much silver and gold they took with them? Everything that matters is what you lay up over there. The treasures you have in heaven, the treasures you have with the Lord, the way you serve the Lord, the way you serve others, the way you love others, that's what matters. Never seen a tombstone that said, I wish I would have had more money. I never seen a tombstone that said, I wish I would have worked more hours. Never seen a tombstone that said, I wish I would have made vice president. Never seen one. You haven't either. Amen? What you do in that little hyphen, that little dash between the year you were born and the year you pass, what you do for Christ is what matters. Jesus told his disciples, if I've washed your feet, so then you ought to wash one another's feet. You look around this congregation and go, oh, there's so many people. I'm sure they got plenty of people to do this and do that. I'm sure somebody will straighten up them chairs. I'm sure somebody will pick up that piece of paper. Sometimes I walk by stuff in the church that needs to be done and just See how long it takes somebody to notice it. Take ownership. See, you see a piece of paper on the floor? It just became your job to pick it up. You just became the church custodian because your eyes saw it. You see somebody go to the altar for prayer? You just became an altar worker. You just got nominated to lay hands on them and pray for them. You hear what I'm saying? You see a person walking up to a door with their arms full, a baby in one arm and a diaper bag in the other? You just became an usher and a greeter. Hey there, let me help you with that door. You just got elected. You just got chosen. Person next to you is weeping in their chair on Sunday morning. The Lord just chose you to touch their life and help them and pray with them and lean in and be near them. Amen? Serve the Lord with gladness. As Jesus washed one another's feet, we should wash each other's feet. Serving builds leaders. There is no such thing as a leader that's not a servant. You want to be a leader in the kingdom? You want to be great in the kingdom? Serve. Amen? How does this look practically? You know, practical Christianity is what the world needs. The world doesn't need our philosophies. The world doesn't need your fancy Facebook post. The world doesn't need your criticism. The world doesn't need loud music. The world needs practical Christianity. What's it look like to do the real stuff in a real way? I've always taught this philosophy, and I still believe it's absolutely God's way of linking the whole body of Christ up. There's two sides of serving in your life that need to exist. Number one, you need to find somebody you can follow spiritually. That follow me as I follow Christ mindset works everywhere at every level. Find somebody in your life that you look up to and just simply go to them and say, God wants me to serve you. I want to serve you. I want to be a servant to you. How can I help you? So I could go to Lois. I'll illustrate this. I could say, Lois, I respect your ministry, and I love what you're doing for the Lord. And is anything I can do to serve in that ministry? I want to be a part of what God's doing in you. Amen? Amen. And then I go over here to Kenan, and my microphone might feed back if I go over here. I go over here to Kenan, and I say, Kenan, I want to help you. I see you're young, and you're trying to work a job, and you're single, and you got life ahead of you. Are you single?
Yes.
Okay, well, don't laugh about it. Pray about it. It's not funny. No, I'm just kidding. But I could say, Kenan, how can I serve you? The girls are watching on this Facebook. I say, Kenan, how can I serve you? I want to bless you. I want to be a servant to you. I want to help you as you're coming along. And if there's ever anything you need, if you need to know anything from an older person, from somebody who's been in ministry for a while, somebody that's married for a while, Kenan, let me serve you in that way. So you got two hands, one reaching up to somebody you honor and respect, and one reaching out and down to someone who might be struggling that you can pull and lift up. And the beautiful thing about that is everybody moves up every time that happens. When I serve Lois, it moves her up and encourages her in an upward momentum. And then I move up and I turn around and there's old Kenan. And he's coming up too. You got my illustration? You understand what I'm saying? The Lord moved on Jonathan's heart, and he did that for David. And if you read, God moved on people's hearts to serve Jonathan. If you look at it, every time somebody committed, like Elisha committed to Elijah, every time somebody committed, like Ruth committed to Naomi, and said, wherever you go, I'm going. Whatever's yours is mine, and whatever's mine is yours. I'm with you. Let's get in covenant with this thing. And I want to talk real quick about covenant, because covenant breeds covenant. When you get in covenant with God and you begin to keep your covenant through tithing and doing what God has called you to do, that's a covenant kept with God. And you begin to serve one another and serve the Lord in that covenant. You watch. Covenant breeds covenant. People that are in covenant with God, before you know it, they're connected and surrounded in ways that are so powerful. Amen? Ruth got a Boaz out of that deal. That's a pretty good deal. I mean, you read about that. It's pretty neat. Amen? Your covenant is going to bring something very powerful. When you read about Jonathan in 1 Samuel 14, I'll let you look at this real quick. Jonathan said to the young man who bore his armor, everybody say armor bearer, come, let us go over the garrison of these uncircumcised. It may be that the Lord will work for us, for nothing restrains the Lord from saving by many or by few. So his armor bearer said to him, do all that's in your heart, go then, here I am with you. According to your heart. The men of the garrison called to Jonathan, and his armor bearer said, come up to us and we will show you something. Jonathan said to his armor bearer, come up after me, for the Lord has delivered them into the hand of Israel. And Jonathan climbed up on his hands and his knees with his armor bearer after him. And as he came after him, his armor bearer killed them. Then Saul said to the people who were with him, now call the roll and see who has gone from us. And when they had called the roll, surprisingly, Jonathan and his armor bearer were not there. In every part of this, it was Jonathan and his armor bearer. Jonathan and his armor bearer. Because Jonathan had made a covenant, a pact with David to serve and to be his brother, closer than a brother, the Bible said, were David and Jonathan. If you'll come to the keyboard, they're going to get the waters of baptism ready, and we're going to introduce our leadership team to you. And I want to conclude with this tip for you today. You've heard it said that married people are, you know, richer and happier and live longer and blah, blah, blah. Well, today I'm going to give you people who serve. I'm going to describe to you how people who serve are happier. Everybody smile. People who serve are happier. People who serve have better friends. People who serve have more friends. People who serve have better marriages. People who serve need less counseling. Mike, say thank you, Jesus. It's true. It's true. People who serve overcome depression. People who serve are more dependable. People who serve are richer because they're laying up treasure in heaven. And people who serve are never alone. If you're washing somebody's feet, whether it's literally or in a spiritual and personal sense, you can't be alone and do that. Amen? People say, oh, I get so lonely. You can't get lonely serving others, just so you know. So, well, I can't do much. Little is much when God is in it. Put it in his hand and watch him do much with little. The little boy's lunch, they could have said, we don't have any food. And he said, well, I can't do anything about it. All I got is 5 loaves and 2 fishes. That ain't going to help anybody. That would be our attitude many times, wouldn't it? I just can't do much, Pastor. The Lord says, let me see that lunch. Come on, give me that lunch. Well, it ain't much, Lord. Just 5 loaves and 2 fishes. There's 5,000 people here. What are you going to do with that? You going to eat it? See, a lot of folks are afraid of what God will do with what they've got. They want to call the shots. Here you go, Lord, but it's just for you. I want you to eat it, Lord. If you'll eat it, I'll give it to you. But, you know, I want to know what you're going to do with it, Lord, before I give it. That always drove me crazy. People in churches that say, I'm going to give money, but I got a string attached to it. I want to see where it goes and how. Let me see what you're going to do with it. Put a plaque up with my name on it because I donated that. Little boy didn't do that. Little boy didn't say, we don't even know his name. Just said a little boy. At least they could have done was told us it was little Samuel. Well, we don't even know his name. He gave his lunch, and guess what? It wasn't much. It wasn't enough to feed 5,000. But it did. Give what you got. Amen. He says in Philippians 2, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of man. Jesus, our example, came to us. If you read the book of Mark, you'll find he came to us as a servant. He said, I didn't come to start killing people and take over. I didn't bring a sword to just start chopping heads. I came to serve, to seek, and to save, and to love, and to give, and to serve. So, well, I used to serve, but they hurt my feelings. Just a quick, humble reminder. They crucified Jesus. Now go ahead and give me your excuses why you ain't serving. You know what I'm saying? The King of Glory came and served. And he said, oh, I was going to serve, but I heard there's going to be a crucifixion, so I think I'm going to go back to building houses. You know what I'm saying? But he didn't. He went all the way. There's going to be bumps. There's going to be feelings hurt. There's going to be people that you serve that look at you like you got three heads. There's going to be people that hurt your feelings. There's going to be people that don't like you. There's going to be people. Christians? Yeah. Yeah, Christians are not perfect. And as long as you think you are, you won't get along with any of them. Amen? But we're going to serve anyway. Praise God. I'm going to invite Lindsay to come up here. She represents our children's ministry today. I want Tim and Ginger Reed to come and represent prison outreach, which Mike Roth is helping lead right now as well. Heidi represents our custodial and river cleaning ministry. I want her to come. Ron Eaton, and I would like Dee Dee to come with Ron because she's become his co-director sort of here in the last few months, and she's helping lead what we call Hay Loft. It's a big part of our First Impressions ministries. There's so many pieces to that ministry, but that's a big part of it. Ben Williams is leading our media right now, and he's able to help you today get signed up for those different departments. We've got Kim Ceeson back there who sets up the schedule for the presentation part of this, and her husband Sean is a big part of our audio. And then we got a whole group of Glob boys back there, and Josiah Lipka, and we've got 4 or 5 new volunteers in the doing the production part of all of this, and so we need some help there. Dale Goodwin, would you step forward? I like your t-shirt. You'll get the second prize for t-shirts today. Dale Goodwin is our ARC, ARC, and it is a recovery connection. Ushers and parking ministry is led by Jim Lipka. Is Jim in the room? He can't be in here. Oh, there he is. He's coming. You can't find him half the time because he's so busy. But Jim Lipka has 700 or 800 volunteers, but he needs more. No, I'm kidding. He has a tremendous group, and he does a great job with that. And you'll love working in that ministry. He's also leading our security ministry, and it is a ministry because your children and your families can be safe on this 23 acres of property, and I appreciate God and his work in that and those that are surrounding him with that. And there are new people coming all the time to help plug in and do more and more with that. Mike and Cindy Teagarden, would you come? They lead a ministry called Deep Water Ministries. But you won't drown. You just get really clean and really wet and really soaked in Deep Water Ministries, because it's a next step. You get salvation and you want to go deeper. You want to get into something where you can serve and grow and be stretched and challenged. They also, as we said earlier, lead our Passion School of Ministry. So any of those areas you want to sign on to, all of these people will be at one of those tables in the back, and you can be a part of that. Mary Coran, step up here next to Jim. What's the name of the group? They've got a new name. American Voters Alliance, AVA. American Voters Alliance. So most of you will stand up here and sing, "I'm proud to be an American." And you'll sing that line, "I'll gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today." Well, there's a way you can help literally do that, and not just sing it, but do it. She has a table out there in red, white, and blue. Get more information, and you can see her. She'll tell you about what's going on to make sure that our nation stays the way it was intended, and we have good and fair elections, and every vote that is a legal vote gets counted. Amen. All right, stand with me if you would. And your response today to the word of the Lord is going to be twofold. I feel like we need a spiritual response and a practical response. Amen? So a lot of times the sermon ends and we end up on the altar weeping and crying. But then if we don't change our behavior, if our activity and lifestyle and commitment level doesn't move, we just got an emotional breakthrough, but nothing really changed. So today it's going to be spiritual and practical. Amen? So bow your head with me and let's make this commitment and this prayer. I'm just going to pray, and I want you to yes and amen if you really believe and really are sincerely going to do what God is calling us to do. Father, in the name of Jesus, I believe and trust you today that your will be done in me. I need you in my life. Lord, I want to love my neighbor as myself. More than ever before, I want to love by serving, by giving, by reaching out to others. Somebody shout amen. Father, I want you to help me today to find my purpose in this world. Help me, Lord, to find my purpose in this church. Help me to find my purpose in my neighborhood. Help me, Lord, direct my steps. I will trust you. I will lean on you. And I will not lean to my own understanding, but I will trust and lean on you. And you will direct my path going forward. God, I'm serious about my life and about making sure that my life counts and making sure that I give and serve the way you give and the way you serve, and I will do what you call me to do. God, I will say to you today, if you can use anything, you can use me. God, I believe the words today that little is much when God is in it. I believe today, God, that you've deposited in me something worthwhile, and I don't want it to stop in me. I want it to flow through me in the power of the Holy Ghost. Let your love be shed abroad in my heart by the Holy Ghost today. And I say it in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody shout amen.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God for the commitment, the new level of covenant and commitment and dedication in this room today. God is doing a new thing in hearts, and we thank you for it, Lord. Amen, amen, amen. Amen.